Hi, I am Alexandros Zacharakis from Pompeu Fabra University, and I will be presenting our work, Updateable Inner Product Argument with Logarithmic Verifier and Applications. This is joint work with Vanesa Daza and Carla Ràfols. So first, I will introduce what is a non-interactive zero-knowledge argument. So we have a prover and a verifier. And they share a common reference string, which we assume to be trusted. So there is a trusted party that creates this common reference string. And now the prover claims that it knows a witness W for a public statement X belonging to an NP language L. So the prover creates a proof pi, a static object, which it then sends to the verifier. And the verifier runs some verification procedure. And if this procedure is successful, then it indeed believes that the prover knows the witness W for the NP relation defined by X. So, what are the properties that we want from such a protocol? First, we need completeness, which means that the honest prover always succeeds in convincing the verifier. We want knowledge soundness, which means that if a prover creates a proof that verifies, then it should know the corresponding witness. Now, for this property, we only consider computationally bounded provers. That is, we require it holds against all polynomial time algorithms. And zero knowledge, which states that the verifier learns nothing more than the fact that the prover knows the witness W corresponding to X. Ideally, also, we want succinctness, which means that the size of the proof should be very small. It should be sublinear in the witness W. So these are all nice, but as we know, no trusted parties exist in the real world. So it remains the issue of how we create this common reference string in a way that we make these properties hold. So in the literature, there are two approaches. The first is to use a transparent CRS. So this means that the CRS is uniformly sampled from a set. And the latter is to use multi-party computation techniques. Now here, the CRS is collectively computed by some committee, and we just need to assume that at least one member of the committee is behaving honestly. Now in the former family, in the transparent family, things are nice. The CRS can be assumed trusted since we can easily sample a uniform string without somebody manipulating the randomness. But in general, these schemes are less efficient, either as far as the prover is concerned or the proof size and the verification. There are a lot of works in this family, such as Stark, Ligero, Hirax, etc. And on the other hand, on the MPC-based approach, the schemes are in general more efficient. So especially the proof size is constant and independent of the NP witness. But we need to rely on non-standard assumptions, such as the knowledge type assumption or idealized models for groups. And this MPC protocol is very expensive. This means that it's really hard to make sure that it is run properly and nothing malicious happens, which makes things kind of difficult as far as CRS generation is concerned. Also, another bad thing is that each CRS that is created is language dependent. So every time we need to prove statement for different languages, we need to rerun this expensive procedure. Now a lot of schemes exist in this family as well, such as GGPR13, GROV16, and many more. Now we can divide the MPC family into two families, the traditional one and the universal and updatable, which was introduced by GROV in Crypto18. So in the traditional one, there is a committee and they execute a standard MPC protocol, so they exchange messages with each other. And after a number of rounds, they collectively output the common reference string. On the other hand, on the universal and updatable model, we essentially have an interactive version of the MPC protocol to create parameters. So what happens is that initially one party creates parameters on its own and publishes it, and then each party can take these parameters, update them, and provide new parameters. And it can it should give a proof that it acted correctly. That is, it essentially included the randomness that was introduced by the previous parties, and so at any point we can stop this procedure and use the CRS, and we just need to assume that the one party updated honestly. Now this makes things much much easier in creating parameters, and no very expensive setup ceremonies need to occur, and it's much cleaner approach. Also, another good thing is that the parameters are universal, in the sense that we can instantiate any NP language given just one set of parameters. So we don't need to create new parameters every time we need an interactive zero knowledge argument for a different language. Of course, this has some limitations, that is the statement size, the language size is bounded by the parameter size we choose initially. So a few words about commitments. So again, we have two entities, which again we call prover and verifier, and they share a commitment key, which again we assume to be trusted. Now, in general, in commitment schemes, the commitment key is sampled by the verifier, but it will be convenient to assume it is given by a third trusted party. So now the prover has a value X it wants to commit to. So it computes using the commitment key a commitment C to this value X and gives it to the verifier, and then other things happen. The prover and the verifier execute some protocol, or they do other stuff, and after some time the prover decommits, so it gives the value it committed to and some opening information, and the verifier can verify this, and if this verification succeeds, it can be sure that the prover was consistent between these rounds. So the properties we want here is the binding property and the hiding property. The binding means that once a commitment C is given, no prover can compute two openings for these commitments, two different openings. And hiding means that the value X used by the prover, nothing is revealed about this value to the verifier if the verifier sees the commitment C. So let's review the literature for updatable NESIX. So all the schemes in the literature have more or less the same properties. So here in this table we omit the initial updatable non-interactive zero knowledge argument of growth, since it has a quadratic prover, which is very inefficient. So as we can see, current work in the literature has a quasi-linear prover. All schemes feature a constant size proof, and they rely on either the algebraic group model, which is an idealized model for groups, or some knowledge type assumptions such as knowledge of exponent. In our work, we create an updatable NESIX, which only needs the standard discrete logarithm assumption for asymmetric groups in one instantiation, and a Q variant of this assumption in the latter. And we achieve this, but we sacrifice the optimal proof size, and we now have a logarithmic size in a logarithmic proof in the size of the witness. Our prover also is fully linear, but it makes heavy use of public key operations, which are in general expensive concretely. So before continuing, I will introduce some notation for representing group elements. So we fix a generator, and we denote an element z to the x as the element x inside brackets. We also extend this notation to vectors of group elements in the natural way, and when we are in bilinear groups, we use subscripts to denote which group we are an element is referring to. Now, the starting point for our construction is the BCC et al. 16 construction, which was later concretely improved in bulletproofs. This scheme is based on the discrete logarithm assumption. It features a transparent setup, and it has a logarithmic proof size. But the bad thing is that verification is linear in the witness size. So we managed to reduce this linear verification time in logarithmic, but we sacrifice the transparent setup for a universal one. So I will give a high-level overview of how this scheme works. So initially, we have a language which we encode as an instance of circuit satisfiability. So this is the problem we built an ISIC for. So we have an arithmetic circuit, and we can naturally translate it to a set of constraints, of quadratic and linear constraints. And we can combine this new problem, the constraint satisfaction problem, with Petersen commitments, standard Petersen commitments. And given some random challenge issued by the verifier, we reduce this to an instance of the inner product language. Now, this language, the statement is that given commitments alpha, beta, and an element z, the prover claims that it knows openings a and b with respect to the commitment keys r and s, such that the inner product of a and b equals z. And now, to prove circuit satisfiability, we just need to prove that this inner product relation holds. And also, it's important to note that this inner product does not need to be zero knowledge. So to have a non-interactive zero knowledge for CSAT, we reduce it to an instance of the inner product, which is not zero knowledge. So how do BCC et al. Solve this inner product? So we have our initial statement here, and the verifier issues some random challenge to the prover, and they create a new statement for the same language. Now the good thing is that this new statement has half the size of the original one, or in more general is a constant factor smaller than the original one. And now we have that if the new statement is true, then with overwhelming probability over the random challenge of the verifier, the old one is true as well. And the security essentially reduces to the binding property of the commitment, specifically discrete logarithm when we instantiate with Petersen commitments. Now, we had our initial statement and we reduced it to one with half size, but the new statement is in the same language, so why stop there? We can continue. And we can proceed recursively, actually, and so the verifier keeps sending random challenges and reduces this problem to a new one. And after a logarithmic number of rounds, the prover can just reveal the witness. The statement then is constant, and the verifier can, in constant time, just verify the witness trivially. Again, note that this is not a problem because we don't need zero knowledge, so indeed the prover can give the witness. And the bad thing is that the verifier is linear in n. Now, the intuition for this is that in Petersen commitments, the commitment key is uniformly sampled, so it has a full entropy. So the verifier every time needs to read this commitment key and compute a new commitment key. Okay, so this is what we attack. So we parameterize the Petersen commitment by essentially sampling keys under different distributions. We will introduce two distributions for this. And we introduce a minimum structure in the commitment keys that allows two things. First of all, we can efficiently update the commitment key in the sense that will become clear later. And also there exists a trapdoor such that holding it allows you to have a verifier that does constant time in its round. So in total, the verifier is logarithmic. Now, how we do this? So essentially, the verifier, using the trapdoor, knows a succinct representation of the statement, which does not involve having the whole commitment key in the statement. And security, intuitively, you can see that security holds if these two distributions are indistinguishable, since the prover in the new scheme has no advantage over the standard prover that was used with the uniform commitment keys. So again, the security reduces to the binding property of the commitments. And the bad thing is that having to know this trapdoor means that we work in a designated verifier case. But ideally, we would like publicly verifiable proofs. So let's introduce these two distributions. First, we have the multilinear distribution. So now we just sample logarithmic number of elements of ZP, logarithmic in the size of the dimension of the vector we want to commit to, and we essentially construct all the multilinear monomials of these sampled keys, which we denote as bar x, and the commitment key is these elements encoded in the group. Now, if we represent a vector, if we think of a vector as the coefficients of a multilinear polynomial, then a commitment to a vector A is essentially the polynomial evaluated at the secret point x1, x2, x log n, and the binding property can be reduced to the standard discrete logarithm assumption with a logarithmic security loss. Also, we have the PW distribution, where we essentially do the same thing, but now we work with univariate polynomials. That is, now we just pick one element, and we just compute the powers up to n minus 1 of this element. Now the binding property reduces to the Q-type variant of this discrete logarithm assumption. Now what happens is that the inner product statement can be seen equivalently in two ways. So on the left hand we see how the prover sees it. So the prover sees the whole commitment key, and essentially it sees what it saw before. But on the right hand side we have the verifier's view. Now we can see that knowing this trapdoor, the verifier can encode the statement very differently. It can say that, okay, the prover claims that it knows two polynomials represented by two vectors, such that their evaluation at the secret points x1, x log n, and y1, y log n are alpha and beta, and the inner product of their coefficients equal to z. So we can see that the size of the latter statement is much smaller, it's logarithmic, while on the other hand, the first is linear. So this we have these two different representations, and the prover behaves essentially the same. So for the prover, it just sees these commitment keys, which are indistinguishable from uniform, so it cannot do much more. And the verifier just does not read the whole statement as the prover does. It uses its trapdoor to encode it. So again, intuitively, security holds under the indistinguishability of the two distributions, but we can reduce it essentially to the binding property of the commitment key. Now, how do we achieve public verifiability? What we do is we compile the previous construction using pairings, using groups that have a bilinear map. And now, instead of having the verifier knowing some trapdoor, we just encode the trapdoor in group 2. So the new key now is determined by the old key and the challenge. And the prover has the whole key, so it can compute the new one, but it also gives some group elements that help the verifier to succinctly verify it. So essentially, the verifier asserts that the new statement is the correct one with respect to its challenge, by using the pairing operation as a Diffie-Hellman oracle, a DDH oracle. So again, security holds under the binding property of the commitment key. So this is now the new picture. We compute in a pairing group now the same elements, and we give the whole commitment key in group 1, and we keep the trapdoor encoded in group 2. Now, the important thing here is that, again, the given only the verification commitment key, the commitment key is fully determined. So we can again write succinctly statement of the form, I know an opening for a commitment that satisfies this property, because the part of I know an opening for a commitment can be represented using just the logarithmic elements encoded in group 2. So we also introduce updatable commitments. So this is essentially the same as the non-interactive zero knowledge argument part, but for the commitment keys. So how we model the binding property, essentially the prover first samples a commitment key, which we denote CK1, and the verifier, the challenger, verifies its structure, and it updates its key and gives it to the adversary. So the adversary now has CK2, and the adversary is challenged with outputting a commitment key, a commitment, and two different openings, such that the commitment key, the new commitment key, is an update of the previous one with respect to the verify update algorithm, and the two commitments, the two openings for the commitment it gave, are different, and they indeed pass the verification procedure. So now this is how we run these operations. So these are the commitment keys, and in both cases, to verify setup, we just check a bunch of DTH relations that should be true in the commitment key. And now to update, what we do is essentially we pick a second commitment key for which we know the trapdoor. So the trapdoor is TI. And we pairwise multiply with the previous key. So we can do that since we know the trapdoor, and to verify that we didn't ignore the previous key and computed a new one, and so the randomness of the previous commitment key is still there. We just use standard proofs of knowledge to show that the discrete lock between the new commitment key and the old commitment key is known to the prover. This is the same in the power PW distribution, but now we just have one element to represent the key in group 2, and we essentially do the same thing. Now in the ML case, to prove correct update, we need the logarithmic discrete log NISX. But if we want, we can even reduce this. So we can use standard sigma protocols for this, but we can also use some transparent schemes such as bulletproofs to reduce the proof size even further. So instead of O of log n, we can have O of log n. In the second case, a proof of update is constant, which is optimal. And now this is the new picture of how to handle the CSAT case. So again, we start with an arithmetic circuit. We translate it to a set of constraints. And we use the new commitment key now, the parameterized Peterson commitment key. Now, using this, we can derive deterministically a CRS for the specific language we want to prove. And again, given some challenge from the verifier, we can reduce this to an inner product statement, as was the case before. Now, so this is the reduction to the inner product statement. Now, as we saw, the inner product statement can be done in logarithmic time with logarithmic proof size, which is good, but the bad thing is that the reduction itself is linear in the circuit size. So this is a problem that existed in previous works as well, and essentially to handle it, we proceed as in Sonic. So we just pre-process the circuit, which essentially what we need is to have a circuit that has a bounded fan in and fan out, and then we delegate the computation of the new statement to the prover by using a permutation argument. So this is very similar to Sonic. It's essentially the same technique, but it's quite technical, and we need to translate this technique to our setting, which is quite different from Sonic. The good thing is that indeed we can achieve in total linear verification time, but now we have some overhead for the prover to in this delegation part, which concretely can make things much slower. So, but what happens for specific languages that may have some structure? So, what we do in general is we start with a language and we translate it to a CSAT instance, and then we can translate this CSAT instance to a set of constraints and proceed as before. But it might be the case that some languages have some natural structure and can be naturally represented as a set of constraints. So if this is the case, we can just remove this step to reducing to CSAT and directly proceed in writing the constraint system. Now, if this system is simple, then no delegation is needed. The verifier can just compute the statement itself. No, this actually should be the case for many, let's say, natural languages, so they can be naturally represented as constraints, and usually these constraints are not very complex. So we demonstrate this in our work by presenting a proof system for range proofs. So what we do is we follow the blueprint of bullet proofs, but we manage to not use this delegation part and use the new inner product argument, which result in an exponentially faster verifier. So that's it. Thank you for your for watching this video. I will be happy to answer any question or receive any feedback. So you can see my email address. Please mail me. Thanks.